Today we are starting a brand new series on advanced tutorials for Civilization 6. The goal here isn't to discuss anything too obvious, instead my goal is to look at some of the less descriptive mechanics in Civilization 6, and hopefully give you guys some knowledge to help you make better decisions in your Civ games. So today we're talking about walls. We're talking about how the game determines how strong your walls are, and whether or not it's even worth upgrading your walls. Before we get too much into this, I want to first give a shout out to a Reddit post by Casual42, who, about a year ago, posted a lot of this information to the Civ subreddit. It was a great start for me as I did this series, and afterwards I actually went to YouTube to try finding some more information because some of it left me a little confused, and I couldn't find anything, and so because of that, I actually decided, let's go ahead and start this series. And so now, onto the basics. One thing to note is there's actually two different numbers that apply to the walls. You have your ranged attack strength, and then you have your melee strength. And what's confusing is when you first glance at the walls, the number you see is only the melee strength number. You actually don't see the ranged attack number. The only way to see that number is to actually have an enemy within range that you can range attack with your walls, and then it shows up there. So why they didn't include that number on the city banner, I have no idea, but hopefully someday in the future we can actually see it because it's a fairly helpful number to have. But anyways, where do those numbers come from? Well, you'd probably assume it's based on your tech level or, you know, what level walls you have or what era you're in or something like that, right? No, sorry, it has nothing to do with that. What it actually is based on is what units you have. So let's start with the ranged attack value for your walls because this is the easiest one to figure out. Basically, your wall ranged attack strength is always going to be equal to whatever the strongest range unit is that you've built. Now, this isn't the ones you've researched, this is only the ones that you've built. Basically, this means that whether you have ancient walls or Renaissance walls, if the best range unit you have is a slinger, they're still going to do the same amount of ranged attack damage, and that's 15, because that's what the attack value, the ranged attack value is on slingers. Now, if you upgrade your slingers to crossbowmen, those ancient walls or medieval walls or Renaissance walls, guess what? They're now going to do 40 damage. So, couple notes about this. Number one, bombard strength isn't the same and it doesn't apply to this. So your catapults, your bombards, your artillery, they're not going to do anything for your walls and their damage. However, ranged ships do help out. So if you're like me and you always find yourself skipping privateers, maybe it's worth actually looking at building a privateer just because it improves all your walls' ranged attack strength. So if that's how the ranged attack value gets determined, then how does the melee defense value get determined? Well, this one's a little more complex because there's a lot of different modifiers that get added into it. To start with, the game finds the strongest melee unit that you have in your empire, and then it subtracts 10 from its melee strength to get the base garrison strength for all of the walls in your empire. From there, each city then has unique modifiers that get added to the base garrison strength to get the final number. So then what other modifiers get factored into the melee defense strength of your walls? Well, if it's your capital, it gets a +3 combat modifier just because of the Royal Guard. Also, every time you build a new level of walls, it gets a +2 combat modifier too. So in other words, ancient walls get a +2 to combat, medieval walls get a +4 to combat, Renaissance gets a +6 to combat. Also, every time you build a new district in your city, it gives you a +2 modifier. And then lastly, if you have a unit in the city that has a higher melee strength than the base, it'll add that too. So this was a lot of little math. We'll go over it in just one second. I'll give you some examples because that's the easiest way to learn this. But one note, your walls are always going to have a minimum defense melee strength of 30 and a ranged attack of 3. What that means is, even if you just have warriors and you haven't built any range units, that's why your walls can still attack. They're only going to attack with a range strength of 3, so they're not going to do a lot of damage, but hey, at least they can do something. Other thing to note is Persia's immortals also count for both range and melee strength, which is really, really good potentially early game. So I know this is a little confusing, so let's actually look at a couple examples of this, and hopefully you can see how this is working a little bit better. Okay, so our first example here is of early game Rome. We don't have our district complete yet, our campus, although it's almost done. We also don't have any ranged units, so if we actually clicked our city range strike, you will notice that we only have a 3 ranged attack strength. That's because we don't have any ranged units built. So one thing to note is we are actually one turn away from finishing our archer. So if I decided to build the archer this turn and I advance to next turn, our range strike would go from 3 to 25 next turn, which is a huge, huge jump. And you'll notice at 3 damage, we're doing almost no damage. At 25 strength, we're going to be doing significantly more damage. Other thing to note about this is right now we only have ancient walls, but if these were medieval walls or even Renaissance walls, we would still only be doing 3 damage with this ranged strike, because the walls actually don't determine how much damage you do with the ranged strike, only your units. So that's why it's more important for us right now to build an archer versus upgrading our walls. So the other number we want to take a look at is our garrison defense strength, which you'll notice is 30. Now remember, that is always going to be at minimum at least 30. It doesn't matter how crappy your melee units are, you're always going to at least have a garrison defense strength of 30. Now, hypothetically speaking, if it could actually be below 30, how would the game actually determine what that number is? Well, first thing the game's going to do is it's going to find your strongest melee unit in your empire, which for us right now is a spearman with 25 melee strength. And then what it's going to do is it's going to subtract 10 from that, and then that's going to be your base defense strength for all of your walls across your empire. And then each individual city is going to add its modifiers to that number. So for our city, it would be 15 plus the fact that we have ancient walls plus 2 plus another 3 since this is our capital, for a total defense strength of 20. You got 15 plus 3 plus 2. The kicker, though, is since our spearman is actually in the city, instead of using the 15 and then adding the modifiers to that, it's actually going to add the modifiers to our melee strength of 25 for the spearman. The reason for that is because our spearman has a higher melee strength than whatever that base defense strength is for our entire empire. So in this case, what the city would do to get this number is it would take the 25, it would add 3 for being the capital, and then 2 for the ancient walls to equal a total of 30. So this number would be 30 irregardless. One quick note about this is anytime the strongest melee unit you have is occupying a city, the city itself will always have plus 10 garrison strength as long as that unit stays in the city. Okay, so now we built the Legion and you'll notice that our garrison strength is now 45. And since the Legion was in the city, it added the plus 5 modifier, 3 from being the capital, 2 from the ancient walls, to the 40 melee strength of the Legion. Now we're at 47. The reason for this is we just finished our campus district, and so now the campus is also adding 2 to the garrison defense strength of the city. Okay, so let's look at this again with more of a late game example to give you guys a better picture of how this works out. So right now we're playing as Russia, it's pretty late game, and our strongest melee unit is a Cossack. So that means our base defense for all of our cities is going to be 67 minus 10. So that means the starting point for every one of our city before we add in the modifiers is going to be 57. So best example is going to be over here. So we start with 57 and then we add in 2 for every one of the districts we have. So we have 57, then we're going to be 59. We don't add the city center because that one doesn't count as a district. So 59, 61, 63, 65, 67. Now you'll notice we're at medieval walls over here, so that's 69 and then 71 because we added 2 for each level of walls. And that's how the game comes up with that number 71. Now, if we came over here to Yarrow, remember, we have the Cossack inside the city. So now instead of starting at 57, it's going to start at 67 because 67 is bigger than 57. And so where we get this number is we have 67, plus then we add in the Holy Site, which is going to be 69, the Harbor, which is 71, the Commercial Hub, which is 73, and then the Ancient Walls, which are 75. Now, you'll notice it says 4 districts out of 5 possible. The reason is because the harbor is being, or rather the water park is being constructed, but it's not yet finished. So in 2 turns when this water park finishes, this number is going to go from 75 to 77. Now, if we move the Cossack out of here, remember this is going to drop by 10 because the Cossack has a 67 melee strength, which is 10 higher than our base number. And you'll see it immediately drops to 65. We go back in there, it's now 75. So you kind of get a picture of how this works? One thing to note is that armies and corps don't raise the base modifier number for your empire. So right here we have a Cossack that has a 67 melee strength. If we make it a corps, it's not going to raise the base modifier for all of our walls. However, if we do put the Cossack, which is now a Cossack corps, inside the city next turn, it will raise the garrison defense strength of this city because the Cossack corps' melee strength of 77 is bigger than the 57 for the rest of our empire. And so the modifiers will get added to that 77 while it's in the city. So there are some advantages to upgrading your walls. First up, if you're going for a cultural victory, every time you get walls, they give you a little bit better tourism. So ancient walls give you 1 tourism, medieval give you 2, and then renaissance walls give you 3 tourism. So if you're going for a cultural victory, better walls are going to help you out in that case. The other thing the walls do is every time you upgrade them, they give a little more HP to the walls so they can last a little longer in combat. Ancient walls only have fortification of 50 HP, medieval walls have 100 HP, and then renaissance walls are going to have 150 HP. And that HP is also going to apply to any encampment districts that you may have. Now, one other thing to note is as soon as you unlock steel, you'll notice that it says it unlocks urban defenses, which gives all your cities an automatic 200 fortification strength and the ability to perform ranged attacks. So that means if we go over to a city like Geneva, which has no walls, you'll notice it has 200 fortification health, and then the city is also going to have a ranged attack. And what's interesting about it is, remember, your ranged attack isn't based off your level of walls, so any passing unit is going to take just as much damage from Geneva as, you know, Rio or Manus or any other city that might have Renaissance walls. And so where this helps is you can look at your enemy in both single player as well as online and multiplayer, and you can determine how strong their walls are going to be just by looking at their units. If they're rolling around with only slingers but they have Renaissance walls, you know that, guess what, those walls aren't going to do a lot of damage to your units. However, if it's early game and you're fighting against India and they're rolling with Varu, you know that those walls are going to be pretty beefy, especially if the Varu are actually garrisoning inside the city. And where this is going to especially help you is when you're trying to defend your city against enemies attacking you. It's probably a lot better for you to take your strongest melee unit and garrison inside a city that's about to be attacked instead of a ranged unit. Although the ranged unit is going to be at risk being outside the city walls and you might lose it if you're not careful, at least your city is going to be able to tank a bunch more damage because your strong melee unit is actually inside the city. And so then one other variable to this is anytime you have an injured unit inside your city, it'll actually drop the garrison defense strength. What's weird is the game doesn't actually tell you this, but if you hover over your pikeman, it still says it has a 41 melee strength, like a full health one. But if we went to attack another unit, you'll notice that in the bottom right corner, it actually has a negative 5 because it's a damaged unit. That is also then reflected up here by a garrison defense strength. So if you take that 41 and you subtract 5 from it, that gives us 36. If then we look at the city, we add in 2 for the ancient walls, that puts it at 38, medieval walls 40, campus 42, 44, 46. So you'll notice that our number here has actually dropped because our pikeman has taken damage. So if I took this pikeman, put him back in the city, then that negative 5 we're getting for it being a damaged unit would actually go away and our combat strength would be at 51. And so that's pretty much everything. There's a few other things of note that we could talk about in this video, but really, if you understand that, it should help you make a little bit better decisions in your Civ game. So I hope this video has been helpful. Since it's a new series, any support you can show it would be awesome. That means liking, that means subscribing, that means commenting. Also, if there's any other mechanic in this advanced tutorial series you would like me to talk about, let me know in the comments. I know we're probably going to do a video on combat damage and probably another one, maybe looking at the score mechanic, but if there's anything else, definitely let me know in the comments. So I'll see you guys later.